I came across this book by Ivan Ilyin that was recently translated into German. I think it was re-translated and re-edited in 2018. And what I found absolutely fascinating about that book is that Ilyin had the experience of Bolshevism, of the Soviet Union, and he was expelled from the Soviet Union. He died in 1954, so it was in the early 50s that he had to leave the country. He was an Orthodox philosopher, and his idea was that even at that time, and I think now it is kind of, it has undergone a potentialization, so it's much worse, is that Christianity, as he saw it, global Christianity, not only Orthodoxy, is kind of what the American alt-right people would maybe call cacked Christianity, so kind of a Christianity that does not stand for their values, for their purpose, for their basic ideas anymore. And Ilyin had the idea that it is kind of a Tolstoyan reframing of Christianity. He said, okay, reframing Christianity not as a religion that can fight for their own values, that can load people with the energy to fight for God anymore, but that is to be pacifistic in a way. This is a misunderstanding of Christianity. Just reducing the battle between good and evil, that is always a crucial and basic concept and a basic division within Christianity. Reducing it just to plain love and love thy neighbor in a kind of stupid and caressing and peaceful sense, that doesn't fulfill the aim of Christianity. So this was Ilyin's main idea. And then he said, okay, if you are a Christian, a believer, then you have to be kind of a fidei defensor. There's a person in Latin who is defending his belief. And if you try to be that, you have to be a person of a strong character, and you have to be able to deal with the problem that it is a sin. So the resistance to evil by force is always something genuinely evil, bad, and sinful. You can't get over it. You can just say, well, you have to, and we have to deal with it, but you have to stand to this kind of being tempted all the time.
But if I may interrupt you here, because then you continue with saying you cannot have an identity without having an enemy, that you're very much in favor of ethno-cultural identities. And it's quite obvious from the book that you consider the Islam as the new or old enemy because of this mass immigration. Is this a correct summary of your idea that, because that's how I read it, that you say, look, you know, Christianity, we need, again, ecclesia militans, we need a militant church, we need a militant Christianity to fight against an old, new enemy, which is the Islam, which is now invading our country, our Europe through. So if Trump would say, make America great again, you would say, make Europe Christian again.
Yes, yes, definitely. Okay. But I think I have to make two remarks. The one thing is that this title, against Allahu Akbar, there is only the possibility of Deus Vult. And then I put a question mark after it. So this is not my stance that I want to defend, but it is a question I put, if we have the same situation, or if we have a kind of continuous historical situation that Christianity has always been genuinely European and always been a battle, a fight of Christianity against Islam. And the second thing I want to add is it has always been a battle against the sinfulness of man himself. It is kind of an inner, and so in everyone, and also an exterior opponent.
I have two questions. One is, is there a difference between resistance to evil as a Christian imperative and developing an ideology of conquest, which is what seems to be the case here? My other question is, doesn't this ideology of conquest against Islam, doesn't it mirror what radical Islamists say and do? Isn't the same worldview that we see here?
But it is, and it is.
It's the Christian ISIS. Yeah. It's as simple as that. It's the Christian ISIS. This is, your thoughts are very identical to what ISIS say in their propaganda videos. When they say we are in a war against the West, we are in a war against Christianity and Judaism, Muslims should pick up guns and go fight and kill each and everyone who's standing in their way. I am myself a refugee. I am myself a Muslim who I believe in democracy, I believe in women's rights, I believe in gay rights. I pretty much approve most of the Western values, and I have no problem living with Christians, with Jews, with atheists, as long as they don't hurt me, as long as they respect my privacy. I will totally and welcomely respect them and be glad to be their friend, their neighbor, their work colleague, or their study colleague. I have seen racism in Germany. I live in Magdeburg, Germany, where Alternative for Deutschland had the highest number of voices. Mm-hmm. And for people who don't know the AfD, they're practically the new Nazis.
That's definitely not true. That is not true.
They got their votes from all the people who are living in Magdeburg. I've seen people hanging pictures for Stalin, for the Red Army, sometimes for Hitler, even though it's against the law. And I've seen them protesting almost every week against refugees, asking for refugees to be sometimes killed or dragged out of or cleansed out of the country. The same thoughts. I think we are living in the alt-right or fascist in general. They have a very selective memory. They forget that in the past 100 years, they brought two world wars. They made half of Europeans refugees themselves in the past 50, 60 years. And when anyone tried to stand up and say, look, fascism is bad, racism is bad, people say, well, they have the right to express their views. But when your views are pushing for violence the same way as ISIS is doing, I really, really hope that people will not listen to you.
But you're not pushing for violence. So
let me answer for violence.
I have to say, you're not making such excellent points, and here's why. Yeah. Here's why.
And I agree.
Why, if you perceive that your community is weak, for some reason, the Christian community is weak, mm-hmm. why do you attribute that weakness? Why do you blame it on people who are not Christian? If Christians cannot...
Yes, agreed.
You know,
yes,
when the Albigensians were alive, they had to be eradicated. This was a very long time ago. What happened to the Jews of Europe, which is a story I know from quite close up, we know. What's happening now, if you can't keep your children Christian, I don't mean your children, I mean if Europe's Christians cannot keep their children Christian by means of teaching them their tradition and raising them in their practices, with a freedom, by the way, which you owe not to Christianity but to secular European liberalism, if Christians cannot raise their children and succeed as a faith, if you have these problems, then address them inside your community. Why do you insist always on going outside your community to find somebody who is preventing you
but
from being
Christian?
But
you're kind of psychologizing. It's like I have my, or we as Christianity, or as European Christians, have our own problems, and we have to work on our problems and not trying to project them on others. This is a kind of a psychological operation.
No.
A religious faith
is only besieged and under threat when its members are not free to practice it. If they are free to practice it, then it does not matter who else is free to practice whatever they want to practice around them.
But
and you become solely responsible, which in the case, by the way, of crusades and sieges and wars, you're not. You become solely responsible for the future of your tradition.
The problem that Europe is so weak in itself leads to the invasion of foreigners, of Islamic
invasion.
Yes, invasion. Definitely.
Okay, let me just talk here. I was born a refugee in Syria, just like millions of other Palestinians who were kicked out of Palestine in 1948 were born there, stateless.
Can I please continue? You can tell me your whole biography,
yeah,
but
sure,
the problem
sure.
is
let me, just
you are
tell
not
you.
The invasion, it's a mass.
Okay, let me just finish so you can hear what I have to say, please. Mm-hmm. So I was born a refugee. Like I told you, at school, they said the Holocaust never happened, whatever. I had all this hate and whatever toward Israel because they just came and stole our land and kicked us out. But they didn't tell us the other part of history where Jews were hunted and killed and burned and gassed, and they had to flee with their lives and look for somewhere safe to live in. That's why they fled for America. They fled for the Middle East and other parts. So it took us years under the revolution, when we did this revolution, just to make our country a better place for all of us to live in. I didn't risk my life and my school and my family to become a refugee in Germany or to make you feel that I have come to invade you. I wanted to stay in my own country and make my country a better place for everyone, for Christians, for Jews, for anyone.
So why
as long
you?
As, can I please finish? Mm-hmm. I was gassed. With chemical weapons, with sarin gas in 2013. I lived for 2 years under siege. I was eating from the rubble. I used to hold children starving because they didn't have like milk or anything to feed them. I held children while they were suffocating because of gas. I held children who were torn up to pieces because of bombs. That's why we left. We didn't leave because of an earthquake. We didn't leave because we were like, let's spend the summer in Berlin or let's go out hiking. We had to leave because the world didn't stick up for their principles. All the high principles you talk about for human rights and treating people as equals, we have discovered in Syria, in the Middle East, that the world doesn't look at us as humans. We are only statistics, we're only numbers, we're only children drowning in the sea looking for safety or getting gassed or freezing inside the refugee tents near Jordan and Turkey. So we were not here to fucking invade Germany. We are just looking for a place to start and just be safe.
I think.
I kind of have the impression that what you perceive as a movement of conquest of Europe by Muslims, this is what you perceive. The answer to this is another conquest. And then you invoke the example of the Crusades.
But we don't have any expansion ideas.
No, no. Like, but you spoke about engaging in a defensive crusade. Now, words have a meaning. Words have history. Crusades were not defensive wars. They were wars of aggression. I come from a Christian tradition, which historically has been aggressed by the Crusades. So were the Muslims. So were the Jews. So to invoke the Crusades as a model of resisting to Islamic threat is highly problematic, isn't it?
Well,
this guy, Ivan Ilyin, is batshit crazy. And
why?
the idea that Putin would be resurrecting him and re-interning him in Russia and bringing his papers back. This is a guy who basically, well, he was a lousy theologian. This is basically his theology as I understand it. God was perfect before creation, had this totality, all unity of God. But when God created creation, he screwed up and he started bumbling through history. So what's the solution according to Ilyin? It's a man on a white horse who can come back in the place is Russia, and has an enemy, and basically can restore paradise on earth. So man-God may be one thing with technology. Man becoming God really seems like a fool's errand today.
CIA studied theology.
We're Renaissance men.
Ilyin died in 54.
Ilyin said,
he died in 54.
May the prayer.
Putin took his body from his Swiss grave
and
gave him a funeral in Moscow. Because Ilyin, Putin really worshipped him.
Ilyin loved war. Ilyin loved war. He said, may your prayer be your sword and may your sword be your prayer. Gee, who does that sound like? Well, that sounds like ISIS. The global jihadist, ISIS, to me.